Ah, we're actually recording. That's great. Managed to get past all the problems. Freezing out here. Coldest day of the year by far. Wow. But it's all good. It's all great. The way to remain calm is to hang out with facts. And if you just repeat facts to yourself, there's something inside you intuitively that relaxes and says, ah, that is true. Let me just abide in that. So abidance in facts is the way to remain calm no matter what happens in existence. No matter what. It doesn't matter. We don't have to detail it. We don't have to catalog it. We don't have to record it. We don't have to be historians for existence. We don't have to do anything. Just hang out with facts. Abide in facts. Fact one, none of us ever left reality. Because where is there to go? Is there someplace outside reality to go to? Is it like some country you fly from one country or one continent to another? You leave that place? No, there's no such thing. There's nothing outside of reality. Reality is all there is. So it's impossible to leave it. Nobody's ever left reality. That's a fact. You can just sort of work on that fact, like a cow chews its cud, just kind of work on the fact. Nobody's ever left. Nobody's ever left. It's impossible for anyone to leave. We can imagine that in the future it will be necessary to leave reality because reality is going to be destroyed, and then we can imagine that there's a way to survive this annihilation of reality, but that's all imagination. We're not leaving reality by entertaining. Just like when one has a dream, lying in bed and they dream they're going all over the place, flying through space and going to different countries and places, they're not going anywhere. They're still, you know, sleeping in bed. So that's one crucial fact. The other is that this is all completely unnecessary. This hypothetical scenario is completely unnecessary. No necessity to it whatsoever. We don't need a contingency plan for when reality supposedly is going to be annihilated, because it's not. It's never going to be. So no need for a contingency plan. Zero. So that's another fact. Zero need for any contingency plan. Therefore, all of existence is entirely unnecessary. That's another fact. One more fact would be, all we have to do is exchange one hypothetical scenario for another hypothetical scenario. That's it. One hypothetical scenario for another hypothetical scenario. That provides continuity to us, which is our big issue. Continuity is our big issue. We don't want to just recognize, existence is totally unnecessary. This hypothetical is completely unnecessary. And just drop it and just go right back to recognizing you never left reality. And reality can never be changed. Just like that, it seems too abrupt for us. That's why God's plan of salvation has an intermediate step. Exchange one hypothetical for another hypothetical. The second hypothetical is the hypothetical of non-annihilation. Okay, hypothetical of non-annihilation. This existence is the hypothetical scenario of annihilation and then trying to figure out a way to survive that. The other hypothetical is hypothetical of no annihilation whatsoever. So nothing's threatened at all. No danger, no threat, and just everything's completely blessed. Now, how difficult is it to exchange one hypothetical for another hypothetical? It's a piece of cake. Piece of cake. If you recognize as hypotheticals, it's the same. It's just the same as this, a hypothetical. So it's made of the same dream stuff. So there's continuity. There's no problem with that. So just exchange one hypothetical for another. Easy. That's it. That's all it in a nutshell. Easy facts. And if you just dwell on those facts, you'll find the entirety of your makeup will calm down, like the ocean, like chop on the ocean, it's all choppy, it'll all calm down automatically. It'll kind of relax, say, I don't need to answer all those questions. All I need to do is just exchange one hypothetical for another hypothetical. Hypothetical of annihilation, hypothetical of for, and then pick up that hypothetical of non-annihilation, which is the world in a existence in a completely blessed form where nothing is threatened. Yes, that too is a hypothetical. And what's to stop it? It's easy. to make a hypothetical. We did it with existence, and the grace of God, the Holy Spirit, does it with the hypothetical of non-annihilation. Just imagines this blessing. That's what it was created for, to bless the hypothetical that we imagine, the hypothetical of annihilation. The prime creator blessed a certain aspect of spirit to have this function of blessing the hypothetical that we picked up, and to present the hypothetical of non-annihilation. We just exchange, simple exchange, simple exchange. That's the entire gist of the highest teaching. Don't need anything other than that. It's just these few little steps. No one ever left reality. It's impossible to leave reality. We're entertaining a hypothetical of annihilation as a contingency plan in case reality somehow is annihilated. Reality cannot be annihilated, so the contingency plan is unnecessary. So we never left reality. This contingency plan is unnecessary. It's all a hypothetical scenario. We can exchange one hypothetical scenario for another hypothetical scenario. 1, 2, 3, boom, that's it. Nothing more difficult than that. And as you just tell yourself, yeah, I can do that. I can do it right this moment. I can exchange one hypothetical for another hypothetical. That's easy. That's not difficult. That's not scary. What's scary would be giving up the hypothetical and returning to full awareness of reality. That might seem like a sudden break in continuity. But we don't need to do that. We have an intermediate step available to us. So all we do is avail ourselves of that intermediate step. And just go 1, 2, 3 and just go over these basics. Keep going over these basics and you'll find everything else recedes in importance. All diminishes in intensity and importance. All the other questions just diminish. You don't even feel like you have a need to answer, to address or answer them in any way. And you say, oh yeah, this is all unnecessary. All this has no necessity to it whatsoever. I don't need to follow any storyline here. I just need to make the exchange of hypothetical scenarios. Simple, completely simple, basic. And one more now. So once we get that, we say, okay, I got that. Very simple. I'm very calm. One more step. And that is, how in the world am I going to function in the world when I accept the other hypothetical scenario of non-annihilation? Well, you will certainly appear to be exalted in some way. People will be feeling like, whoa, what's this? Some intense blessing. I mean, it just, yeah, okay. You won't be able to hide your light, in other words. How could you possibly hide your light when you are viewing this blessed hypothetical, blessed scenario? Blessing, existence in a blessed form, this hypothetical of non-annihilation. It's sublime and beautiful and peaceful and all of that. So of course you're going to seem to be unbelievably stable. And so how do you deal with that? This is pragmatism, a 101. Because surely that question must arise as the obvious question. Well, wow, I don't want to draw attention to myself. You know, forget it. Who wants that? Who wants that? If you've ever been well known in existence, any time you realize, holy cow, you don't really want that. You don't want people constantly coming up to you. Yeah, you just want your life, and you want some freedom from that. So. Of course, if you suddenly are drawing a lot of attention, that's not easy to deal with. Let's be honest. So, let's look at that. Let's look at that, because that's where we're headed. If we can look at the basic root of all misery and 1, 2, 3 it, just like that, 1, 2, 3 it, no problem at all, then, of course, you're on the verge of making the exchange. When the exchange is made, of course, you're going to have some kind of rare equanimity and something that simply other people have not experienced, have not come across. It's like seeing a fish that is, what is that fish? I've never seen anything like it. And of course they're like, ah, what is that fish? So what you do is you simply say, no, this is normal. This is actually normal condition, and all of you are in a highly abnormal condition. This is simply what's normal. I just stopped trying to be abnormal. In other words, I stopped trying to annihilate myself. And when one stops trying to annihilate oneself, they recognize what they normally are, what they really are, which is that which just cannot be annihilated, which is spirit, which cannot leave reality. Let's put it that way. That which cannot be changed, cannot be threatened, changed, can't leave reality. That's normal. That's entirely normal. It's everyone else that's abnormal. So the exalted condition, that's normal. That is a normal thing. That's the way everybody really is. But everybody is desperately trying to figure out, believing that they can be annihilated. So they're trying to figure out how to survive that annihilation. In other words, they're making the annihilation real to them. They believe it's real, and how to survive some real event that takes place like that. So of course they're identifying with vulnerability. But this whole saga of threat and annihilation and how to survive it. So of course they're not stable, because they say, well, we're working on it. We're working on how to survive complete instability, total chaos, total annihilation. So they're the ones who are abnormal, and you just have to accept their abnormality and realize it's temporary, because they haven't left reality either. And so you just overlook it, basically. You just reassure them that they never left either. Nobody's left. And no contingency is necessary. You just basically reassure them of the ABCs, 1, 2, 3. Nobody's ever left. This contingency plan is entirely unnecessary. Exchange one hypothetical for another hypothetical. The hypothetical of non-annihilation. And that's all you need to know. And that'll make you normal too. You'll start to normalize. You will start to normalize. So who are these great saviors, these great gurus, teachers, etc.? Avatars, avataras, who come into the world. They're just normal. They're the normal ones. There's nothing abnormal about them. They're the normal ones. They simply accepted what they are, what reality is, as it is. That's all. They just accepted facts. They're not trying to annihilate themselves. They realize what they are cannot be annihilated. So they're just normal. That's all. This is a whole different way of looking at it. Turn it around. All the great ones who have come in the world that people have worshipped and bowed down to, they're the normal ones. They're just simply normal. And if we can take them that way, it's a lot easier for them to circulate among us. They don't want all this hubbub as far as looking at them as some super freakish, abnormal sort of situation. What do they want that for? No, they want to be seen as completely normal, and then accept the fact we're the ones who are in this hypothetical state of abnormality, of vulnerability to annihilation. So we're the ones who need to give up our abnormality in order to be normal, in order to recognize that we are normal. Just like with the sleeper wakes up and realizes that they're just sleeping in bed and they're normal, everything's fine. Whereas they're having some crazy, bizarre, weird dream. They say, oh, that dream was really bizarre and weird. Very abnormal stuff was happening in the dream, but now I feel completely normal. Like that. So nobody is going toward abnormality. One is simply dropping the abnormality and becoming normal. So this peaceful, blissful stability, that's the norm. That's normal. It's not a statistical norm here in the world, but we're talking about a real norm, a factual norm. It is the factual norm. It is our true condition. Everything else is an attempt to destroy our true condition, which is completely insane, abnormal, because it cannot be. So when one pursues an insane goal, one appears to be very abnormal, full of dread, confusion, fear, vulnerability, threat, all this stuff. But the fact is, one has never left reality, and one is perfectly safe and normal. So if you meet some great ambassador of certitude, some great guru, avatara, savior, saint, sage, you name it, bodhisattva, whatever, just look at them and say, ah, okay, so that's what normal is. They're simply normal. That's what normal is. Don't exalt the condition of being exalted. Say that being exalted like this, or totally stable, blissful, peaceful, that is normal. That is the norm. And look at your own condition that you're still clinging to as that which is abnormal, extremely abnormal. And then all you need to do is make this exchange. That's it. Simple exchange of hypotheticals. You're not exchanging hypothetical for a reality. You're exchanging hypothetical for another hypothetical. So there's continuity. You feel very comfortable, very much at home. Piece of cake, like just like taking another step down the street. And then when you feel what you feel is you say, I'm remembering what it's like to be normal. That's all. And then you just tell others that's what you can do too. You can remember what it feels like to be normal also. And by giving up just the 1, 2, 3 ABC, just look at the basic facts. Just abide in these basic facts. Consider these basic facts. Jesus gave out advice that we should consider his words like a cow chews its cud. At least that's what I was told the original Hebrew was actually. That's what he actually said. He said, look, the cows, how they chew their cud constantly, right? All day long, they're chewing the cud. We're supposed to consider facts like that. Constantly our mind must be chewing it. And gradually, it gradually dawns on us. This is my testimony because that's what I've done. Gradually, it becomes easier and easier and easier. And you just say, hey, yeah, no big deal there. Nothing frightening there. So obvious, of course. It becomes very matter of fact at some point. It becomes very matter of fact instead of some kind of wild, crazy, abnormal speculation or something like that. The idea of becoming normal is not a crazy idea. It's not something abnormal. Not at all. How could it be? That would just be confusion of terms. It'd be level confusion of terminology. That's entirely normal to be normal. That's the most normal thing there could possibly be, to gravitate back to being normal. And set down the extreme bizarre abnormality of believing that we're going to be annihilated, that reality is going to be annihilated. Totally bizarre, whimsical notion. Set that down. That's normal. That's a normal thing to do. That's what normality does. So we're headed towards normality. That's all. Leaving behind this bizarre, crazy scenario, hypothetical scenario of figuring out a way to justify annihilation, which involves just total bizarreness. Now, the end times, we're in the end times. Let's say December 21st, let's call that the beginning. The end times began in 1999, August 18th, 1999, really. And then 9/11 really kicked off the weirdness in a big way. That was the external expression of something that had been going on subtly. So we've been in it for a while, but December 21st, 2012 is when externally we will start to get the full flavor of the end times externally. Internally, on subtle levels, it's already been taking place to an extraordinary extent. But it has not externalized yet to the fullest extent. So what's going to happen now is this externalization of the intense weirdness and abnormality, which is existence. And it's going to be very painful, and it's not going to get better. It's going to continue to be painful, and it's going to go on and on and on and be very, very, very painful as all this nonsense of modeling annihilation externalizes, and we try to figure out ways to deal with it, various different ways to deal with that. There's lots of different ways. Some people embrace death. Others feel that it's a great release that'll save them. Others try to survive. Others try to inflict death on others. All this kind of nonsense goes on and on and on and on and on, all completely abnormal, totally abnormal. So all I'm saying is just sidestep this. Just decide to be normal. That's all. Just decide to be normal. I deserve to be normal. I deserve to remember how it is to be normal. I deserve to remember how it is to be normal. That's it. No big hoopla about that. Teachers don't come here to do a bunch of miracles and throw rainbows up in the sky and stuff like that. No. They just say, just to tell, hey, you can be normal like me. Just to make the exchange of hypotheticals and you'll be normal just like me. That's all there is to it. You don't need a contingency plan for reality. Reality doesn't require a contingency plan. So don't worry, you don't need one. I don't have one. I don't have one at all. And there's no need for it. No one can ever leave reality. There's nowhere else to go. Reality cannot be annihilated, can't be harmed or changed in any way. So just simple reminders of that. Simple reminders. That's it. And you don't need all the other stuff. You don't need all the hoopla. Of course, existence is going to get very weird, to say the very least. It's going to get very weird and very painful. But you don't need any of that. You don't need any of it, because it's all totally unnecessary. You don't need to go through any of that. You can just sidestep the entire situation. If that's your intent, that's what will happen. You can literally see the make the exchange of hypothetical scenarios, and the whole situation will appear to you be completely blessed. No annihilation at all. Because one hypothetical is just as true as another, isn't it? That's right. So why not choose that? Why not? It's still hypothetical, but it's just as relevant as the other. In fact, but what it does is it is easily translatable back to reality of just dropping the whole issue of annihilation entirely. That's how you do it. But it's why not do that? We're perfectly free to do that. Since this is just a dream, why not dream a different dream? What's stopping us? We don't need to learn how to survive annihilation, because it'll never happen. So why not just dream another dream? Accept another dream. Accept another hypothetical. Just say, oh sure, why not? Why not see a blessed world? Just it's no more or less real than this annihilation scenario. So if it makes me feel better, if I enjoy that more, yeah, why not? So it brings us back to normality, which is what we want. So the worst you could say is why not, if you look at it honestly. And then you can also find a lot of reasons why it'd be a great thing to do. But at the very least, you could say, well, why not? Why not? Why not do that? Why not exchange one dream for another? They're both equally unreal. But why not dream a happy dream? So the one that helps you wake up from dreaming and drop it all together. Why not have a happy hypothetical? Why have a miserable, painful hypothetical? To what end? Well, of course, we're trying to figure out how to survive annihilation by believing that annihilation is real, and that somehow our capacity to believe that it's real will actually enable us then to survive it. This is what's called magical thinking. And it's simply something that has absolutely no basis in any fact whatsoever. It's just a wishful, magical thinking type of equation. It's like saying, I'll make something that is totally unreal, has no basis in reality whatsoever. I'll make it real. And then by making it real, that shows that I have the power over it. And therefore, I will survive it. I'm greater than it. So these are just wild flights of fancy, really, of a magical wishful thinking. Why continue on with that when you can just accept a different hypothetical scenario? Just to make a simple exchange of non-annihilation. We don't have to come up with any craziness, any magical thinking at all. Since this is all a dream, there's nothing preventing the Holy Spirit from dreaming a different dream of non-annihilation. Piece of cake. Why not? So if we can get that sense how easy it is, and why not do it, then that puts on a different basis. It's a different basis. We kind of feel a different basis, like, hey, it's silly not to do that. There's really no reason not to. It's still a dream, which we're used to. We're still dreaming, but it's a enjoyable, blissful, stable, happy dream. and helps us remember that we never left reality. So it's a plus plus, win-win kind of thing. Might as well do that, might as well. So you just have this sort of a whole different kind of feeling to the whole situation. It's just, you start thinking, why not do that? Yeah, it's a good idea. I like that idea. Let's make just exchange hypothetical scenarios. One dream for another. Neither one is real. So what's, why not? The first one was completely unnecessary, and the second one is unnecessary in reality too, but it only is necessary in relation to the first one of being a corrective or being an alternative, so there's continuity. And eventually we'll realize we don't need any continuity. Once we get that continuity, then we'll say, I don't even need dreams at all. I don't even need dreams at all. I'm not afraid of the continuity problem anymore. But right now we have this continuity problem. And this is really the key problem of all, is the continuity problem. If we can just recognize this, then the whole thing becomes super easy. And we just admit, yeah, I'd like to drop this crazy hypothetical, but I'm kind of afraid of what would I be experiencing. So just exchange one dream for another, and you say, oh, I'm still dreaming. But it's a beautiful, beautiful dream. No annihilation, no threat. Everything's blessed. Everything's seamlessly peaceful, overlaid with unconditional love. I'm still dreaming. I feel smooth continuity, no problem whatsoever. That's the way to go. That is the way to go. And when you're able to just kind of see it along these lines, everything simplifies to an extreme extent, and you're not pestered by all this extraneous stuff which previously pestered you like crazy. It's like fleas. It feels like you don't have any fleas. Like if you're a dog and you've got all these fleas and just beset by fleas. Hundreds and hundreds on you, biting you constantly. That's like, you say, well, that's like I used to be. I used to be like that, where all these concerns and doubts and considerations just constantly assailing my mind. My mind was just whirling. I couldn't sleep, trying to figure out. How do I get peace of mind? How do I do it, etc. Now, you're just looking at this and you just, none of that stuff arises. Like you don't have any fleas. Nothing's biting you anymore. And you just kind of simply say, That's a pretty good deal. I like that deal. I'm thinking I'm going to take that deal. Just exchange one hypothetical for another. What's the big deal? Why not? Why not do that? Why not walk across the road and live, dwell in a beautiful mansion instead of living in a rundown, rotting shack? Why not? They're both your homes. You have two homes. Well, you have two dream homes, so to speak. One is this rundown, rotting, decaying, stinking, wet, moldy shack with no electricity, no water, no nothing. And you're like in there hovering in a hovel, shaking in the dirt. And right across the street, you have this incredibly beautiful palace, just scintillating in splendor. All you have to do is just walk right across the street. Just walk through the front door. The door's open. You walk in. You realize, oh, this is my house too. I can have either one of these houses. Which one do I want to dwell in? And then eventually, by dwelling in the palace, we realize, I don't even need this palace because reality is so much better. I never left reality, but now I remember I never left it. But it's hard to remember you never left it when you're dwelling in this incredibly dilapidated, moldy, musty, dank, dark, rotting, collapsing, stinking hovel. It's hard to remember you never left reality, right? But if you're dwelling in this incredibly lit up, gorgeous palace, then you can say, hey, I remember that I believe I remember that I was in a situation what more wonderful than this. I'm remembering how wonderful it was. And then you say, oh yeah, okay, I can remember. I never left in the first place. And I have my mansion now is infinitely greater. But it's a lot easier to wake up, to drop the whole issue of annihilation from this, from experiencing the hypothetical of non-annihilation. It's a lot easier to wake up by a factor, almost like an infinite factor, infinitely easier. Theoretically, you can wake up from just from this hovel that you're shivering in darkness. You can, of course. You can remember, hey, I never left reality, and I don't need any contingency plan for annihilation, and so I just drop the whole contingency thing right now. Boom. Yeah, you can do that. But it's extremely rare. Super, 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 super rare that that's ever, 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 ever going to be done. But it theoretically, you can do it. But it's the same reality, whether you do it that way or whether you choose the intermediate step of exchanging hypothetical scenarios. Walk across the street and go into your palace, go into your McMansion, go into your gorgeous place with landscape lighting everywhere and lush velvety lawns and beautiful palms and shimmering pools and fountains and gorgeous lit up home with everything is so scintillating and sparkling and fresh and clean. There's no dust and everything just works flawlessly, and you just enjoy just hanging out there in this sumptuous palace and gardens and all that. You just enjoy just walking around smiling. I'm happy. Hey, this is really neat. Hey, I used to live in that hovel over there. In fact, it's still mine, but I decided not to hang out there anymore. I'm hanging out here now. People who are still in their hovels will say, how did you get that palace? What's going on? You know this? You say, you got your palace too. Look across the street. It's right there. Just move in. Just walk across the street. Move in to your palace. This is normal. This is at least much more normal. The abnormality is vanishing like a mirage. It's not perfectly normal to engage with any hypothetical, but this hypothetical doesn't last long, and it's just there as an intermediate step. So you feel much, much more normal. You say, hey, I'm getting a lot more normal. This feels a lot more normal. Yeah, this blessed vision of blessedness, vision of Christ feels a lot more normal. Very close to normal. So these are the considerations that when you actually put your attention on them, you'll find all other concerns dropping away. Because within you, you'll say, yeah, this is it. I know this is it. So why do I need to bother with all this other stuff? I don't need to. I don't need to get any answers. I don't need to resolve anything. I just need to walk across the street to my palace. Exchange hypotheticals. That's all I need to do. That's it. Nothing more. Because this entire scenario of existence is completely unnecessary. So what do I need to judge? What do I need to learn? What do I need to do? Nothing. Nothing whatsoever. What do you need to remember? You did. You don't need to remember anything. But you did. You can remember that you used to live there. Or used to at least to dwell in this rundown shack. Yeah, sure. Of course. You're aware that, yeah, I used to live over there, but I was really, really didn't like that. So I didn't enjoy it. So here now I'm really enjoying this living in this palace. So the key during these times, I mean, we're in the end times for everybody. Don't judge anybody one way or the other, because nobody ever left reality. So everybody is your brother in Christ, brother, sister in Christ. Everyone, without exception. Don't hate on anybody. No, because then your attention is off of exchanging hypotheticals, and it's trying to stay with one hypothetical of annihilation and say, well, they're trying to annihilate me. I want to annihilate them. I want to survive their attempt to annihilate me, and all this kind of stuff. And you're not exchanging hypotheticals at that point. At that point, you see. So it's better to just continuously consider making that exchange. unbroken consideration is the way to do it. Like a cow chewing its cud. Even when the cow's sleeping, I think they're chewing their cud. I wish we could do that. When we're sleeping, I don't seem to be able to do that. Sometimes, sometimes I have dreams when I wake up. I realize that I've solved the problem, and while I'm dreaming, I've resolved some incredibly important situation, and I've got it very clear about it. But I wake up, I can't remember what it is. This happens a lot, which means it's just beneath the surface. The whole resolution, this entire thing for me, is just beneath the surface. But when I wake up, I say, "Oh gosh, I just can't quite remember what was that." And it's like then if you contemplate for several hours before you get up, just keep doing it, then you can kind of draw it, get clear about what it was, or at least you can enter into some profound clarity and simplicity. The greater simplicity you feel, that means the closer you're getting, where all these other extraneous concerns just drop away and you feel like it's not even but worth looking at them anymore. And that is a very welcome condition, It's not, you haven't finished the job yet, but it's easier to focus on facts at that point. You're not bedeviled by all these fleas and all these itches and bites you've got. They have to scratch this itch. It's like you've been getting all these flea bites, and you feel you got to constantly scratch this one, and then scratch this one, and then go over to scratch that one, and you just keep going around in circles, because after a while, the scratching effect wears off, and then it's even worse than before, and you got to scratch that one, like a mosquito bites. Oh, gosh. How very well I know this whole path, because I've been through the whole doggone thing, both subtly and externally. I mean, I once was on I took a ferry out to an island in the Gulf of Thailand, and it was a little tropical island, Koh Samui or something like that, I think it's called. And I took a taxi around the island, and there was this beautiful tropical beach. I said, "Oh my gosh, I just want to stay here for a while." I was just sitting there, like in almost bliss. This is like paradise. I have this beach to myself. There's no people here. I couldn't believe it. What a beautiful, the sand, everything's wonderful. And then it started getting a little bit dark. I said, "Oh my gosh, okay, I need to get back to my hotel." Well, guess what? All the taxis had stopped running, and there was not a single bit of transportation to take me back to my hotel. And all I had on was a pair of swim trunks. I was so caught up in this fantasy of finding some sort of perfect tropical scenario that I completely forgot about the practicalities of the situation I was in. And so I said, "Oh well, no worries. It's tropical, wonderful. I'll sleep on the beach here." I said, "Hey, that's great." And everything was great. Until I heard this sound, this humming. I said, "What is that? Is that some kind of mystical humming or some om or something? What's going on?" I tried to interpret it in a very spiritual way. And then I saw this cloud coming towards me. And the humming got louder and louder and louder. And it was a cloud of gigantic mosquitoes. And so I spent the entire night desperately fighting off the mosquitoes. And I guess I was too dumb. I should have gone in the water, I guess. But then there's stuff in the water you don't want to deal with either. But the end result was, when I came back to the hotel the next day, I had 156, I think it was, mosquito bites on my body in one night, 156, and it almost killed me, almost died from that. It was so, the suffering was so intense, and of course every single mosquito bite was just raging with burning itching, and I was already very sick at the time, actually, and it almost killed me. It was absolutely horrific beyond imagination. I could not imagine anything so terrible. So I went from this so-called ideal tropical scenario to this unbelievable suffering. because of all these mosquito bites. Now, that was an external expression of an internal situation where I was bedeviled by all these spiritual questions. Because when I mistakenly tried to help people of the world out in identifying with this hypothetical as if it was real, trying to figure out what, try to solve the problems of the hypothetical instead of exchanging hypotheticals, all these conundrums and problems that people have arose in my mind. And then I felt it was my duty to resolve all these problems. So my mind was beset with just constant mosquitoes, a swarm of mosquitoes biting my mind constantly. And the enormous itching and anxiety that this caused. Because I was trying to help everybody and trying to resolve everybody's problems. And I had lost track of the sheer simplicity of exchanging hypothetical scenarios. And I couldn't remember it. I knew I had lost the simplicity of it, but I couldn't remember what it was. Unbelievable, huh? Totally unbelievable. How it just shows you how clever the deception is of this world, that I couldn't even remember the sheer simplicity of it. That is just... amazing, truly amazing. And then the great good fortune was that I came across A Course in Miracles, which just explained it very simply, actually. And now I can remember what the sheer simplicity of it. But before, I couldn't remember. I could not remember. Isn't that amazing? It is. It's just, at this point, I cannot believe it. How could I possibly not know, not remember? Because the world, it grabs a hold of your compassion and pulls you into its embrace, as it were, and saying, you're here to help us. We know you are. So here's how you help us. We need help here and here and here and here and here. And you're not able to say no. You're not able to say, whoa, whoa, whoa. That's why having gurus in the world, great sages and saviors and avatars, etc., etc., are so important, because they're like a cornerstone that says, no, don't do that. Don't try to solve the world's problems. Stop. Just remember to exchange hypotheticals. Super helpful. Super helpful. And for some reason, the Western paradigm is so powerful in its folly and deception that you get pulled into it, and it's super hard to accept the guru. It's super hard to accept that. We don't want to. We want to do it on our own. We want to figure it out. We want to solve problems. We're so into solving problems. The Western paradigm is so obsessed with solving problems. When you get into that paradigm, it is just incredibly difficult to get out of it, to see the sheer simplicity of exchanging hypotheticals, because that is so simple. In a culture that is obsessed with solving complex problems, it's like it doesn't exist. Yeah. So I had a super difficult time. Incredibly difficult time. But all the while, the entire time, I knew I was forgetting just some key, some very simple key. That's all I needed, and I just couldn't remember what it was. And I'm still waking up from that. It's like the stupor of Western civilization and global civilization now is essentially the Western civilization has globalized itself of being obsessed with solving problems instead of exchanging hypothetical scenarios. Now, thank God for India, which had not completely westernized and gotten into this problem-solving mode during the last century, and their great gurus arose there. Quite a few really fabulous teachers arose there, and that was supremely helpful, very, very beneficial. Now, of course, India is embracing the Western culture more and more of problem-solving. In fact, most of the software in the world is written by Indians, which is hyper focus on computing, problem solving. directing us away from the sheer simplicity of salvation, just exchanging hypothetical scenarios. So, from that, the culture, high spiritual culture of India, where they were not obsessed with solving problems, where they are much more attuned towards making this exchange, as it were, that the grace of the guru, so to speak, surrender to the guru, accept the grace of the guru, that sort of thing, which is basically the same thing as exchanging hypothetical scenarios. It's a little romanticized. They tend to kind of romanticize it. That's one benefit I can say of the West, that if you do see it, if you are able to remember it, then you're actually able to be much more direct and clear and adamant by using the kind of Western terminology. You don't romanticize it at all. And you can just be completely stark, absolutely clear, absolutely direct. It's blah, 1, 2, 3, that's it. Whereas in India, you need to do the song and the dance, as it were. And it's very mythologized and romanticized and attenuated in various ways and stuff. And you actually can bypass all of that. But it's super difficult to do it in the West. No question about it. Brutal path here in the West. Absolutely brutal. Because the forgetting is so extreme, and the demands that you solve problems is so extreme, and out of your compassion and determination, you end up trying to solve the problems of the world, which I did. I literally was trying to figure out how to solve every single problem in the world. And I just go around the day and I just notice continual stream of problems. Every single person I saw, I'd say, oh my gosh, look, they're sick, they're old, they're decrepit, they got issues, they got problems. I could see all their problems. I said, I got to solve every one of those problems. So I literally felt every single last problem in the world, I had to come up with solutions for that. And my life had, and I couldn't find any peace of mind until I did that. And so my mind was just going a million miles a second, just going so constantly fast, like a supercomputer. And of course, there's just, supercomputers take a lot of energy. It completely drained me of energy constantly. I was just absolutely drained of any energy. It took all my energy to run the supercomputer. I was trying to find answers to all problems in specifics, like each, as if each one were a separate problem. And so then I was able to get directed back on track towards realization that all this is completely unnecessary. We don't have to have resolutions to any problems. Not a single one. Not a single one. Think about that. We don't have to come up with a solution to any problems whatsoever that ever arises in existence. None. We don't have to solve cancer. We don't have to solve mental illness. We don't have to solve disabilities, learning disabilities, developmental disabilities, old age, sickness, rebirth. We don't need to solve any problems whatsoever. None. All we need to do is simply exchange hypothetical scenarios. That cures everything. Everything. In the scenario of non-annihilation, there are no problems. None. That's how it's done. That's the only way that it's done. So here in the West, that is extraordinarily difficult to get this viewpoint across and enough to even speak about it. That's the hard part. I was aware of it, but I couldn't externalize it. That was the problem I had here. I was aware of the answer subtly, but I couldn't externalize it because it was just like there seemed no way to do it. Nobody, when it's just the way that it is here, how can you externalize this and say this in the paradigm here? The paradigm is so strong here. The collective mindset is so strong and all-encompassing that to say these words sounds like utter gibberish. Complete utter gibberish, complete madness. It seems that way. Complete disconnect, utter and complete disconnect. So how do you feel that you're helping others if you feel there's a complete disconnect? You feel like, no, I have to do it some other way. I have to do it the way that will connect with them. So it is extremely difficult to externalize this. So some of you may know what I'm talking about. Subtly you say, yeah, I know this is true, but how do I externalize it? That seems just incredibly difficult. And it is. That is, it is. It's just unbelievably difficult, really. It's been just a massive effort on my part to work towards externalizing this, just going over and over and over, and very difficult. It's like there's some extreme phobia to doing it, like the most phobic thing imaginable, that you simply can't quite do it no matter what. But if you see somebody doing it, then you say, ah, it can be done. I can do that. It can be done. And that's the benefit of anybody that can do this, externalize it. To some extent, you can say, hey, I can do that. Sure, why not? That breaks the ice. It's like I felt like I was an icebreaker, and breaking the ice is real tough. But once the ice is broken, the others can say, hey, yeah, we can do this too. Like Roger Bannister ran a 4-minute mile. People said it was impossible. Once he did, other people started doing it quite frequently, actually. They say, hey, we can do that. It's possible. Externalizing that the sure simplicity of the remedy is the tough part. Making the exchange is not difficult, but externalizing this is. And the final difficulty is to actually make the exchange and then be in a world where everybody looks at you like you're some kind of a severe anomaly, whereas in fact they're the ones who are severe anomalies. They're severe abnormalities, meaning they're engaging with complete abnormality. So that lies ahead for me. That's my task ahead that I see, is I have to accept it for myself and then deal with the fallout of that, which people say, I was watching the Long Way Around series, and the bike riders are in Mongolia and riding across the landscape of Mongolia, and there's absolutely nothing anywhere, not a single sign of human humanity anywhere, and it looks like no one's ever been there, ever. No matter where they go, it's like that. There's not even any roads or anything, and then they're driving around. And they stop somewhere, and they're cooking, eating some food, and this young boy rides up on a horse out of nowhere, and the boy rides up to him, and he's looking at him, and his mouth is just like, he's like this, like, just staring like that, staring at him, and they say, hello, how are you, he's never seen anything like it. His eyes were like big saucers, his mouth was hanging open. And he's just completely dumbfounded. He has absolutely dumbfounded, this young boy. He has no idea what. And then finally he just turns around and just goes off. And it just, that was it. I've never seen such an expression of pure dumbfoundedness ever. It was literally what he was seeing with these motorcycles and the way they were dressed and everything. You couldn't have been more, to him, that was something that he never even remotely imagined or envisioned. Anything like that. So, and they're just like bike riders, just riding off a ride, you know, around the world. And to them, they're completely normal, but not to someone who's never seen it. But it was okay. There's no problem. The guy rode off, and he probably will go back and tell people what he saw. And maybe someday he'll get used to it and say, oh yeah, those were motorcycle riders I saw way back then. So, there was no abnormality there. It was just that someone came across something that they hadn't envisioned possible. So in this world, when you make the exchange of hypothetical scenarios, there will be those who never imagined this was possible. So of course there'll be who's this? You know, you must be some great savior, or did God send you as a savior and all this? And you shouldn't say, no, I'm just normal. This is just normal. I just exchange hypothetical scenarios, and that's the way to do it, and there's no big deal, and I'm just the same as you. I didn't leave reality. You didn't leave reality. It's just a matter of fact. And for me, it's completely normal, and others who understand this, to them, okay, it's not a problem. But to those who never imagined such a thing as possible, never even thought about for a second, I don't know, to them it was going to seem like, you know, they have no comprehension of what's going on. And they'll say, well, you're either a devil or an angel, or, you know, something like a Christ or the Antichrist. They don't know. They have no way of determining. Well, deep within, they know it's all okay, it's good. But conceptually, they don't know where to place you at all. And it's just some extreme. So they're not sure which extreme to place you in. So all that has to be managed somehow. And there should be a way to manage it. Usually it's within ashrams or retreats where people are able to be around others who are familiar and comfortable with this. You don't just go out riding in Mongolia on a motorbike and expect the people to be blasé about it. They're going to be like, what in the world is this? Wow. Like some astronauts just landed there. Could have been aliens landed there. For all that the Mongolian horse rider knew, these people were a mirage or something, some incredible dream that he was having. Probably went home and said, I just had this a vision. I saw these two angels or something, and this incredible vision. Then they're gone. I don't know. They just vanished and probably didn't even think it was real. So that all of this can be normalized as well. And that's what I have, you know, that's what I look forward to. And we're headed up now very close to, just a couple days away now. Tomorrow's Wednesday, and the next day's Thursday, and then, boom, we're here. We're at the moment where it all gets very juicy and it gets very sidesteppy. It gets very painful and very sidesteppy. So it's a great, 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 great time, actually. Those who want to work on overcoming annihilation, it's their cup of tea. They're going to love it. At least, along with all the severe pain, they're going to feel like it's a real teaching moment, a real teaching time. A lot of life lessons to be learned, and so they'll be very juicy for them. And for those who are going to sidestep it all, it's going to be a great celebration. Great celebration, a sublime celebration. Wow. Not some disco party, but a sublime celebration, just like an inner feeling like, This is great. I'm finally sidestepping. I'm finally making the exchange. This is just, couldn't be better. Thank you, thank you, thank you for this time. So it'll be the best of times. It'll be the best of times and the worst of times coming up now as the subtle play externalizes. It externalizes. It's like in the mountains and with the snow as a pine cone falls, it's falling. That's the subtle thing. No sound, just quiet. You can see it falling, but it's all very quiet. Everything's still. It's just falling. You think, oh, maybe nothing's happened. And then it hits the snow, poof, and goes down into the snow. And you have a more external event, it seems like, when that happens. Or a snowflake coming down, it seems so beautiful, comes down and lands on your face, and you go, ooh, it's cold, and then it melts, and everything changes. We have all this subtle stuff going on underneath the surface that's been going on for quite some time. And now that is going to externalize, and we'll experience it here at this density. We'll experience it here now, which means it's going to be a very painful, a lot of suffering, a lot of very, very intense suffering that won't stop. And also some very sublime sidestepping of making the exchange of hypothetical scenarios. So those are the best of times. So I very much look forward to these times, and started the celebration. I'm trying to help those who are close to me not freak out, not get too stressed out. So got some comfort foods to kind of help them out tonight. I went out and said, I gotta have to help them out because they're stressing out, and got some chocolate mint fudge brownies and some chocolate and vanilla ice cream and some cinnamon bread and some, you know, it's great stuff, you know, stuff that just like makes you kind of forget about everything else for a little while. I didn't eat any of it, actually. Did not touch any of it. Don't really feel like I need to. I feel very up, very positive, eager eager and can hardly wait for these times to really emerge as they are, to really start emerging. And then the opportunities will be so great, and we'll really be able to make a decision. Say, let's sidestep this. Let's exchange hypothetical scenarios. Let's gravitate towards accepting reality as it is. And it's so simple, so simple. Let's go towards simplicity, and let's leave all this severe irritation behind forever. Let's leave all this mental ferment behind. Let's drop it. It's not needed anymore. We don't have to judge anything, solve anything, resolve anything, learn anything, know anything about existence. No. All we need to know is exchange hypothetical scenarios. That's it. Just know one thing. That's it. That's all we need to know. So it's a great time, and I look forward to these times. I look forward to the big boost, as I have been seen for so long. That will be a big boost, and I eagerly looking forward to that, and how that plays out, I don't know. I certainly hope that it does occur, because I've seen that there's something along those lines, not the details, but some really profound help that simply reassures us that, yeah, all you need to know is exchange those hypothetical scenarios. That's it. That's it. Nothing more. And it reassures us of that. So, a couple more days. Just carry on. Carry on. Carry on. Calm. Centered. Simple. Dwell on the facts. Dwell on the simple facts. The 1, 2, 3. No one ever left reality. We don't need any contingency plan for the annihilation of reality. So this is nothing but a hypothetical scenario we're experiencing existence. There's zero necessity to it. And all we need to do is exchange hypothetical scenarios for the one that the Holy Spirit has for us, which is the hypothetical scenario of non-annihilation. No contingency plan. No annihilation. No, and that's just like existence in a completely blessed form. The continuity factor is there. And then that's easily translatable back into dropping the whole issue of annihilation altogether. And we don't need to worry about that step. We only need to worry about making the exchange of hypothetical scenarios. That's it. That's all we need to know. And if you just dwell on those facts, and then after we do that, just express to people that, no, this is the norm. This is actually what normal is. This isn't abnormal. I'm not some exalted, special creation of God here to save the world or anything. I'm just exactly the same as you and everybody else. I never left reality. You never left reality. I just accept that I never left reality. You're still working on a contingency plan for when you think you will leave reality. In other words, reality be annihilated. You're just working on a contingency plan. That's the only difference. That's the only difference. We're all one, actually. Always. No, impossible to be other than that. So, see, I'm normal, and you're working on a very abnormal situation that's not necessary. And just present it that way, and hopefully the big boost will enable those who make this exchange to be supported. To be supported, that's what I'm hoping for. Because let's be honest, it's not easy. If you were to make this exchange, you would certainly draw attention. You would. You would be radiant. I mean, you'd be radiating this assurance and peace and bliss and people are going to notice. Of course they'll notice. And how do you deal with that? Well, there should be some help with that. Should be. Yeah. So, here we go. Here we go. Here we go. Here we go. Very great. Very great. Can't hardly wait. All right. Don't worry. No worries. This is a time of ultimate blessing, really. Time of great opportunity, great blessing. You don't want to miss these times for anything. No way. No way. You made it this far. You deserve to go through this most opportune time in history. Fabulous time. Great work to get this far. Just steady as you go. Okay, that's it.